And so this morning, the previous 2 weeks, Pastor Peter laid the foundation talking about the circle of the blood from heaven, God had determined, and then Jesus came to earth, and then Jesus took it back. And this morning, I'm going further to talk about the precious blood of Jesus Christ, but with a focus on the fact that you have been discharged and acquitted. Amen? You have been discharged and acquitted. We will start this morning with the help of the Holy Spirit from 1 Peter 1:18. Let's just appreciate what that blood is about. Hallelujah. You have been discharged and acquitted of the blood. Every saint has a past, and every sinner has a future. It's all a question of choice, because the table is set before us. The price has been paid. I pray this morning that by reason of the power in the blood of Jesus, our hearing will be sanctified to make quality decisions in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver and gold from your vain manner of life received by tradition from your fathers. Verse 19, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. This is the beauty of Christianity. It's always personalized. It's not just us. It's not just something in pie in the sky thing. He zeroes in because God is sure that if you receive it, you will talk about, you will encounter it personally. It will be real for you in your personal situation. And he said, it has been foreordained for you. He said, who verily was foreordained before the foundations of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. Amen. We'll be looking at the blood of Jesus Christ. And the interesting thing is that food only becomes precious when there is hunger. Isn't it? Freedom becomes precious when somebody has been incarcerated, as those who have been in Guantanamo Bay for 15 years. And you wake up and you're thinking, when is the day of my release? And some are even there. Like, if you listen to the radio program this morning, our church radio program on Spark Sunderland, you will have heard part of this. Some are there, and they don't even know why they're in prison. Amen? They just don't know. And so when freedom, the smell of freedom comes their way, they know what it means to be precious. And that's why sometimes I wonder if we truly know what it means that the blood of Jesus Christ is precious. I believe God this morning for incontestable results to become our evidence by reason of the precious blood of Jesus Christ. I don't know where you are at, but he knows. Because from the foundations of the world, he has been ordained to do this for us. And he is manifest in these last times for you. For you. Say for me. Yes, it's not selfishness. It's not greed. That's what the Bible, it's for me. He's for me. I'm drunk with that consciousness. Throw stones, throw sticks, say things about me. It doesn't move me. Why? He has been manifested for me. His blood avails for me. And that's the punishment that Satan deserves. When you are confident enough to know that a price has been paid for you. It doesn't matter what that habit has been. It doesn't matter what that addiction is. It doesn't matter what has been said. It doesn't matter what the accusation is. Our topic today is, you have been discharged and acquitted. Will you step out? Will you step out in that freedom that has been eternally purchased? Will you cast that fear away? Like the blind man Bartimaeus, cast away the garment of poverty, the garment of begging, when he heard that the master was passing by. Will you cast it away? Will you cast away that confidence in your ability? Can't you see that good decisions are not enough and New Year resolutions don't solve anything? But there is help. There is help for us in that blood, the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Amen? In Mark 15, verses 1 to 6, you can also see it in Luke chapter 23, verse 18, in John chapter, in all the Gospels, the people cried, "Give us Barabbas. Give us," can't check, you maybe for you want to put it on the screen, Matthew 27, 22. That's the question that comes to all of us now. Pilate, knowing that Jesus was not guilty, he had to do something. There was that pressure. And they said, he said to them, Pilate said unto them, Matthew 27, 22. What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called Christ? And that's our question today too. What will you do with Jesus Christ? With Jesus, who is called Christ? What will you do? They all say unto him, that's the people who were baying for the blood of Jesus, but they didn't know it was for our favor. They said unto him, let him be crucified. And the governor said, why? What evil has he done? But they cried out the more, saying, let him be crucified. When Pilate saw that he could prevail nothing, but that rather a tumult was made, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I'm innocent of the blood of this righteous person. So a righteous person went to the cross, was crucified. And a criminal like you and I was released. Jesus said, no man can take my life from me. John chapter 10, verse 18. John chapter 10 said, no one can take my life from me. I lay it down. So they didn't kill him. No man taketh it from me. Let's back up to verse 17. It says, therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life that I might take it again. Some of us can't even lay down our pennies. But he laid down his life. Some of us can't lay down our sleep to pray for others. Some of us can't miss even one meal for the love of his kingdom, to pray that his kingdom come. But he says, therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life that I might take it again. No man takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment I have received of my Father. Remember, it says, as the Father has sent me, so send I you. The same love that the Father had for him, the Father has for you and I. Amen? So, Don't sit there and think, oh, well, that's Jesus. And by his precious blood, he has made it possible for us to enter into that same kind of life. Barabbas was a type of a sinful man under the penalty of death. And Jesus could have refused, if he didn't want to step into his place. Something else would have happened, and Barabbas would still have had to die. But Jesus said, I lay down my life. He did it voluntarily so that Barabbas could be discharged and acquitted. Now, let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 2. So we have every reason to be joyful when we come to church. It doesn't matter what the whisperings of the enemy is. You know that you know somebody paid the price for your liberty. Because darkness makes light incontestable, the effect of light. By pureness, by knowledge, by long-suffering, by kindness, by Holy Spirit, love unfeigned, I think, 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 2, it says, for he saith, I have heard thee in time accepted, and in the day of salvation have I helped you. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now, faith is now. Now is the accepted time. Can you imagine what it would have been like if Barabbas, when they said, give us Barabbas, give us, and then Jesus humbly accepted, and Barabbas still refused to go? But many times, there are things that we are being set free from by the blood that has been shed for us. And it appears as if sometimes we are not letting go of those things we are set free from. Now is the day of salvation. When Pilate asked that question, what will I do with this Jesus, the Christ? What would you do in that situation? In that thing that you came to church with in your heart this morning? Are you going to let go at the altar this morning? Because the blood avails for you and I. The thief on the cross, Matthew chapter 27, verse 38, Mark chapter 15, verse 27, in all the Gospels, that thief was on the right hand or on the left, whatever. Some people have contested. But you see, people waste their time on irrelevant things. Whether he's on the right or on the left. And they say, you know, when you look at the picture of the cross, as if none of us was, we were not there. And they didn't have cameras in those days. But that, Jesus tilted his head to the right. So the man must have been on his right side. Whatever. All we know is that the Bible says in Romans 10, verse 13, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Romans 10, verse 13. That thief, he was already sentenced by the court of man. And judgment was being meted out on that cross to him. And he had a companion, another thief, with whom they could both mess Jesus Christ up. Say, you said you are a savior. What are you doing on the cross? But that thief on the right, and it would be nice for us to go back and look at that story. Let's look at, I think it's shorter in Mark 15, because I just want us to finish. Mark 15, let's look at Mark 15, verse 27. And with him, they crucified two thieves, the one on his right hand and the other on his left. And the scripture was fulfilled, which said it was numbered with transgressors. The scripture was fulfilled, even up to the letter that he was crucified with transgressors. The same way, because as he is, so are you in this world. Because as the Father has loved him, so he loves you. Scriptures can be fulfilled in your life too. From Genesis to Revelation, as you stand on those promises, because of the precious blood of Jesus Christ that has ratified this covenant, scriptures can be fulfilled in your life too. Now, this scripture was fulfilled in the life of Christ in order to set us free. It says it was fulfilled. And they that passed by railed at him. They insulted him, wagging their heads and saying, "Ah, thou that destroyest the temple and builds in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." So also the chief priests mocking said among themselves with the scribes, "He saved others, himself he cannot save." Is it strange? They say, oh, and they go to church. Oh, and they are preaching prosperity, but where is their money? Oh. But the day of glory can never be denied. Amen? Hallelujah. And so, let Christ, the King of Israel, descend now from the cross that we may see and believe. And they that were crucified with him reviled him. So they reviled him. And then, but that thief challenged his mate that, look, he is not like one of them. Hallelujah. I'm standing on that scripture because he recognized the Son of God. That, look, he did not sin like us. We are guilty of what we have been charged, guilty as charged. Jesus said, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Some people have argued that. Was it that same day? Or was it where the comma is and all that? Theologians. But the issue is that man, his sentence to hell was discharged. He was discharged and acquitted from sentence to hell. The woman at the cross. And the woman caught in adultery. John chapter 8, verses 1 to 11. Please read it in your private time. And they all came. John chapter 8, verses 1 to 11. It said, oh, she was caught in adultery. And the sentence is that she must be stoned to death. And they wanted also, it was also a trap to get Jesus to say, oh, if Jesus says, free her, they will say, well, you want to break the law of Moses. If Jesus says, kill her, stone her to death, they will say, oh, you want to break the Roman law. Because at that time, Israel was under the rule of the Romans. And they have no power to pass a death sentence. So they were only coming to trap Jesus. But the Bible says, no one could catch him at his words. You have his life now. No matter what the enemy is trying to set up to trap you, they will not catch you in your words. In the name of Jesus Christ, can I hear your amen? He has been made unto us wisdom and power and sanctification. We have the mind of Christ. Amen? And so when they come with their mischief, the wisdom of Christ that you have received, Christ living in you will stir up and give you an answer on those days in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen? Hallelujah. The woman caught in adultery. And suddenly, they said all they said, and Jesus writing in the sand, before he could raise up his head, they had disappeared. Witnesses disappeared. And so if there are no witnesses, there is no case. Case dismissed. Hallelujah. I don't know if some of you are catching some things and connecting to your liberty. Case in John chapter 1 verse 17, the Bible says the law came from through Moses, but through Jesus Christ, grace and truth. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. And that is what was released in that situation. Grace and truth became the weapon of her discharge and acquittal. Those who brought the case against her were not there to tender their evidence and pursue it. We have been redeemed from the curse of the law. It says, the Old Testament hanging on the tree was the sign of the curse. And Jesus, like I always joke, well, it's not meant to be a joke, really. It's reality. That Jesus could, if it's just the blood, if it's just that it's his blood, he could have slashed his hands and drained the blood and the blood onto the ground. And that's all. The need for the blood justification will have been there. But he was made a curse. Let's read Galatians chapter 3. Jesus, we just celebrate you. Thank you, mighty God. Galatians chapter 3, verse 13. Well, let's back up a little. I'll read from verse 10. It says, for as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone that continues not in all things which were written in the book of the law to do them. That's why run away is him. You can't handle it. If you want to stay under the law, it says, you must continue not in all things that are written in the book of the law to do them, but that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God. It is evident. For the just shall live by faith. We were not there when Christ was crucified, but by faith we believe. Thomas was one of the disciples, but because he did not see the resurrected Christ, he still doubted. But we are already blessed. I'm telling you, I'm intoxicated by all that the Bible says. And it says, blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. And here we are seated today, seated in the worship of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, even our Savior Jesus Christ who died for us. We are blessed. Tell your neighbor, you are blessed. Empowered to succeed in every area of life. Hallelujah. And it goes on to say, and the law is not of faith, but the man that doeth them shall live in them. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangs on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. And so, that woman caught in adultery, discharged, and acquitted. No witnesses could stand before the righteous judge, because they were just being mischievous. Where was the man who was involved in the adultery? But Jesus Christ is the righteous judge. And that's why I think it's in the book of James. It says, don't commit yourself to man seeking justice. The only one who is just is God, your righteous judge. Because sometimes when something happens, maybe false accusation, you want to explain to this person, explain to that person, because you want your image redeemed. Nobody can redeem your image. The blood alone does it. The blood of Jesus Christ. The justification that comes from him alone does it. The more you try to explain yourself to man, the more they compound the story. The more they complicate the issues. So look to the righteous judge. And that woman was discharged and acquitted. When we are about to be condemned, the blood of Jesus will speak for us. Amen? Let's look at a few scriptures about the blood of Jesus. Romans 5:18, justification. Romans 5:18. Therefore, as by the offense of one judgment, of one, big grand great grandfather Adam, judgment came upon all men to condemnation. Even so, by the righteousness of the free gift, one free gift came upon all men unto justification for life. Verse 21, that as sin hath reigned unto death, even so my grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. Let's also look at Romans 3:23. We will not assume things. Let's go into the word of God. The anointing is in the word. It says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All have sinned. So don't come to church and feel somebody else is better than you. We all have sinned. We are standing because the blood justifies us. And not just because the blood justifies us, there is no judgment that is effective until it is pronounced. Even if a judge has written all his judgment, he has listened to the case, if he does not make a pronouncement, does not open his mouth to say guilty or acquitted, that nothing is happening. It's not enforceable. So if the Bible says we have been justified, we are acquitted, all have sinned and come short, and unless you enforce it by opening your mouth and declaring it, nothing will happen. You have a responsibility to open your mouth and declare these things. It says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Remember, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. To declare, I say, at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him who believes in Jesus. The justifier of him who believes in Jesus. You must be glad. You are justified. The one you have come to worship is your justifier. Amen? That's why we can confidently say, therefore now there is no condemnation to us. Hallelujah. Let's look at 2 Corinthians 5:21 and 1 Corinthians 5:7. 1 Corinthians 5:7. Here the scripture says, purge out therefore the old leaven, that you may be a new lump as you are unleavened. I wish somebody can read that for me in the Amplified. Can somebody please take the mic and read it for me from the Amplified version? It's always good to also see in modern translation. Or if you do, if you have found it, I'll just give you the mic. Praise the Lord. Purge out therefore the old leaven, that you may be a new lump as you are unleavened. For even Christ, our Passover lamb, is our justifier, is our Passover lamb, is sacrificed for us. Hallelujah. Please, can somebody read that for me in modern English?
In NLT, Bible said, get rid of the old yeast by removing this wicked person from among you. Then you will be like a fresh batch of dough made without yeast, which is what you really are.
Please, can we have it in them? Because NLT and NIV, sometimes they try to avoid the issues of the blood. But that's our reality. Please, can somebody please read it for me?
It says, clean out the old leaven so that you may be a new batch, just as you are still unleavened. For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed.
The message version. Somebody has the message.
The message said,
yes.
Your flip and callous arrogance in these things bothers me. You pass it off as a small thing. What is anything but that? Yeast, too, is a small thing, but it works its way through a whole batch of bread. A whole bread goes pretty fast, so get rid of this yeast. Our true identity is flat and plain, not puffed up with the wrong kind of ingredient.
Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover lamb, is the right ingredient. Any other thing is a lie. You know, those who make puffs on bread and all this, they know what, how the yeast works. But Christ, our Passover lamb, is sacrificed for us. And finally, looking at being discharged and acquitted in the court of Pharaoh,
it's our fourth example this morning. And Moses came with Aaron, his brother.
Says,
God says, let my people go.
And he will not hear.
He will not obey. Everything that is disobeying the law of liberty
in your life,
will bow to the power of Jesus Christ.
Even today.
Because the Bible says, now is the day of salvation.
Now is that time.
Everything that is disobeying the law of liberty
will bow to the power of the blood.
Amen.
The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and all that dwell therein.
The kingdom of God rules over all.
There is no other kingdom.
There is no other king.
There is no other lordship
that can defy that which Christ has paid for by his blood.
You only need to enforce it, because the Bible says that the heavens of heaven is the Lord's, but the earth he has given to the sons of men. He wants you to come back into Eden. Eden is that place of dominion, because that's God's original agenda for man, that we will exercise dominion and authority over everything that he has made. And when the first Adam did it, the second Adam paid the price. His precious blood was shed so that we can get back into Eden and exercise dominion. So no one should be a wimp. No one should be bowed by any issue.
There is restoration. There is restoration. You can get into Eden and exercise dominion again as God has ordained it. It says, let us make man in our own image and in our own likeness, in our own character, and let him exercise dominion. That was why death could not hold Jesus, because he did all. It says he obeyed the Father. He says, my Father is with me. He carried the presence of the Father. He came as man. But he says, my Father is with me because I do always the things that please him. It's our choice. It's our choice to do always the things that please him, that guarantees his presence. He's available. The blood is available. It's our choice. We want the Edenic life. We want to exercise the dominion that is ours. Then, let's do always the things that please him. And know that he is with us. That's what we celebrated that Christmas time. Emmanuel, God with us. He is with us. He's paid the price to be with us. Now, they were there in the court of Pharaoh. Let my people go, and he will not let them. The miracles happened, and they contested it. Just like the devil will want to contest the miracles and the doings of God in the lives of his people. They are what? You got a job. I'm not a Christian. I got a job too. Oh, tithe? I don't pay tithe, but this also happens for me. I'm even better than what you are getting. I got a promotion. You didn't. But they don't know anything. It's just like in the palace of Pharaoh. Moses cast down his rod. It turned into a snake. They cast down their own rod too. It turned into a snake. But the day of reckoning came. When the miracles they defied could no longer be defied, because the one who is behind it all is long-suffering. He gave them a long rope. He gave them a long rope. Don't take the patience and the long-suffering of God for granted. Don't take it for granted. Pharaoh took it for granted. He thought he was contesting with all the other little gods that they serve. And then that day came when the Passover lamb was sacrificed. And he was hit in the jugular. And from that day, Moses did not need to say, "Let my people go." The Bible says it was urgent upon Pharaoh. Pharaoh was frantic to say, "Just go." And they didn't just go. They did not go empty. The enemy that has pursued you when you have chosen to be on the side of the Almighty and has thought all your efforts made it look like silly child play, today is the day of reckoning, because the blood will give you incontestable evidence in the name of Jesus Christ. When the blood came on the scene, they were secured from the torture, the afflictions, and the horror of being slaves, of satanic manipulations. Whatever kind of satanic manipulation that is going on in your life, in your family, in your career, in your studies, in anything that surrounds you, in this household of faith, the blood, we lift up the blood standard today. We apply the blood of Jesus Christ to every situation. And we say, enough is enough. Favor and release attended to the Israelites because of the blood. Whatever happened in the Old Testament was just an image of the real thing that was going to happen through the spotless Lamb of God. Remember, we read that scripture? Christ, our Passover Lamb, is crucified. He has been sacrificed for us. The Exodus story shows us that the ultimate instrument of discharge and acquittal is the blood. Because every other thing didn't work. In fact, at a point, Moses even was kind enough. When they begin to get troubled by some of the things, the plagues that came upon them, he will appeal to Moses. And Moses will appeal to God. And God will say, okay, lift it. Then he will do another one. And he will do another one. People like that. They think it's a joke. That child of God is a joke. No more. No more. We are not jokers. The price that has been paid for our liberty is too much, is priceless for anyone to toy with. Let hell hear it today. No more. Can you tell the enemy, no more? Because the blood avails for you. Hallelujah. All the miracles, kindness, helping, you know, when the flies came, Moses prayed again, the flies lifted, locusts came, all the different plagues. He wouldn't hear. Kindness only hardened him. Kindness only hardened him to do worse. And then the best he could do for them was a partial discharge. That, okay, some of you could go, but don't go with your children. Just, you know. He didn't know that the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, has a plan. But the Passover lamb, when it was sacrificed, a lamb for each household, and they apply that blood, because it's not enough for the blood, for the lamb to be sacrificed. If they hadn't applied it as God instructed, then they would have been caught in the destruction. But for as many as applied it, applied the blood of Jesus, they applied the blood of the lamb that was slain, they were free. And they left with gold and silver. And they had favor. From this day, you will enjoy favor in the name of Jesus Christ. Favor cannot be withheld from us. We are not the ones to be disfavored, because we believe in the price that has been paid for our justification. And we apply that blood this day upon this work, upon this ministry, upon everyone who belongs to this family of God by faith. We apply the blood of Jesus Christ for favor. They did not leave empty. And so the blood of Jesus is the spiritual force of freedom. In Revelation 12:10, so I have to start rounding it up. Revelation 12, verse 10, you will see the accuser. And I heard a loud voice. Let me back up to verse 9 so that you can get the story. It says, and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, who deceived the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now, remember that word again, now, don't leave this place the same today. Now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, who accused them before our God day and night. Accusation is the work of Satan. None of us will become accusers of our brethren in Jesus' name. But he does it day and night. That is his assignment. He's faithful in his assignment, if you want to put it that way. The Bible says he goes to and fro. Remember the story of Job? He was going to and fro. That's his assignment. What is your own assignment? Your own assignment is to wield the weapon of freedom. As he's making noise day and night, you too, you are displaying, you are speaking the power of the blood, your power of justification. You are displaying your weapon, your freedom card, your passport. You can imagine if somebody goes to, you want to travel and you get to Heathrow Airport and then they ask for your, if you have the British passport, you don't go to the long queue and be staying there. You just, we confidently, you walk to the checkout place for British citizens, and you just move on. But if even your passport that is green or black doesn't have even the, it doesn't even have the limited leave or anything on it, you will hesitate a little. You'll be wondering, which side shall I go? But we are not in a place of hesitation. Amen? I want to hear your shouts of joy. We are not in the place of hesitation. The blood avails for us. We have the passport, freedom. Some of us will celebrate British passport more than we are celebrating what we are talking about. I know British passport is red, but the blood of Jesus is red. But red is different from red. Amen? Hallelujah! Blessed be the name of the Lord. We must constantly display. That display is not because you are just holding a card. It is your joy. It is your loving your brother. It is your serving God in spirit and in truth. It's your commitment. These are the ways you display your freedom. That is the way you display your liberty, by the blood of the Lamb. Okay? Because when you are free, you are free. He says, whom the Son of God sets free is free indeed. You will be glad to come to the house of the Lord. You will be proud to witness. Nothing is holding you back because you are intoxicated by the liberty you are enjoying in Christ. And that you have dominion over all the works of Satan. Some people, when they mention Satan, say, I'm not there. I'm not part of those talking about him. Don't want them. I don't want any trouble. You are not in that class. Amen? You have the life of Christ in you. You have liberty. It doesn't matter what that situation is. You have the force of freedom. The blood of Jesus Christ. The blood. That song says, what can make me whole again? Says nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I'll just make a little bit of explanation when I've been talking about discharge and acquittal. And I'll give you an example before we go to the communion table. If, for instance, the police gathers evidence against somebody that the person has done something wrong and then presents it before a judge, the person who is being accused of doing that thing can write an application, what we call discharge application, asking the judge to discharge that matter because the evidence is not enough and that there is no case against him. The judge can look at it, go through it, and say, yes, the evidence is not enough. Like, the witnesses walked out, and so there was no case against that woman. Although she obviously admitted that she committed adultery by waiting, standing back. She didn't run away with them. She stood back. The man who didn't appear remained in his sin. But she who stood and stayed before Jesus, Jesus cleansed her and set her free. So the judge could say, well, the matter has been discharged. And then dismiss the case. But if in future, being discharged is not enough. Because if in future they gather more evidence, that case can be repackaged. That could be a retrial. But then, if the person is discharged and acquitted, the word acquitted means, okay, we found evidence, it has been presented, and everybody talked, and still, the evidence is not enough to convict that person. The evidence is not enough to say this person is guilty. then he is acquitted. When somebody is discharged and acquitted, you cannot bring that case back again forever because of the law of double jeopardy. Somebody should not suffer twice for the same offense. The law of double jeopardy. And if you recognize what Jesus has done, he has taken your place. Because even Pilate said, this is a righteous man. He said, he is a righteous man. He didn't commit this any offense. But he chose to go. He chose to go for you and I so that we can say, you can't accuse me again. You can't try me in your court again. Because that we have something called, well, if they attempt it in law, we have something we call autrefois acquit. It's a French word that you can't come a second time. I've been acquitted once. You can't come again with this matter. Amen? And so you can stand and say, they can't come again. The blood is enough for me. The blood is speaking for me. Amen? And that word was derived from the scriptures. The Bible says in Isaiah 43, come, let us reason together. Is it make your case? Let's read it, Isaiah 43, as we now prepare to go to the communion table. I just want you to give a thought to the things we've been talking about. Amen? 43 verse 26, just as we round up on this today. 43:26 says there, put me in remembrance. I'll back up to verse 25 so that you can enjoy it. I am he who blots out your transgressions. Remember, your transgression is not just blotted out anymore. In the New Testament, it has been washed away. If something is covered, it can still be found. But this one is washed away by the blood of Jesus. It says, let us plead. It says, for my own sake, I will not remember your sins. Put me in remembrance. Put me in remembrance. Tell your neighbor, put God in remembrance. And it says, let us plead together. Declare thou that thou mayest be justified. Declare. I told you, there is no judgment that is enforceable until the judge has spoken you are free or you are guilty. He can't just write a book and close his notebook and says he has passed judgment. No. And so, God is telling us in his word, put me in remembrance. When that thing comes to disturb you, put him in remembrance. Display your freedom card. And declare thou that thou mayest be justified. What will you declare? It's not all those negative things you hear on TV and all those things, all those other people's prayers. This will not be this, my that will not be. No. You declare the promises of God. Hallelujah! You declare the promises of God. They are positive. They are sweet. They are life imparting. Amen? And you have assurance and confidence forevermore. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As we sit down, as we prepare to go to the communion table, you have heard this message, and the Bible says, today, now is the time of salvation. What would you do with this Jesus Christ and the price he has paid? Now, if there's anyone who needs either rededication or you want something else to pray about, please indicate. There is no shame in the household of faith. After the service, you can come to the altar, but don't go away without enforcing that which Christ has done for you. Amen? Praise the Lord. In John 8:29, as we go to that table of communion, please, you can be meditating on what matters to you from all that we have spoken. Amen. John 8:29. Jesus was speaking there. I've quoted it earlier when I was teaching. It says, "And he that sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I do always those things that please him." And then come to verse 46 and 47. It says, "Which of you convicted me of sin? If I say the truth, why do you not believe me? He that is of God hears God's words." He that is of God hears God's words. I will stop there, because the second part doesn't concern us. We hear God's words. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's time to come back to Eden. It's time to be released from the pit wherein there is no water. And as we come to this table of covenant, Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." What is, are we remembering? All the things we have spoken about today. His body was broken for us, and his blood was shed for our justification, our justifier, our big brother who has gone ahead for us. What can make me whole again but the blood of Jesus Christ? And so, Father, we just thank you for this table of covenant. We thank you for the table of covenant. We sanctify it. We receive it unto ourselves this morning in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord.